Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Confessions of a Shopaholic by Sophie Kinsella, narrated by Emily Gray. This work is copyrighted 2001 by Sophie Kinsella. This recording is copyrighted 2002 by Recorded Books. Becky Bloomwood loves to shop. More precisely, she lives to shop. The problem is, Becky can't really afford it. She's already in debt because of all her extravagant purchases, and when she's in debt, she gets depressed. And when she gets depressed, she has to go, well, shopping. And now, Confessions of a Shopaholic.
Endwich Bank, 1 Stallion Square, London, W13HW. Ms. Rebecca Bloomwood, Flat 4, 63 Jarvis Road, Bristol, BS10DN. 6th of July, 1997. Dear Ms. Bloomwood, congratulations! As a recent graduate of Bristol University, you are undoubtedly proud of your performance. We at Endwich are also proud of our performance as a flexible, caring bank with accounts to suit everyone. We pride ourselves particularly in our far-sighted approach when it comes to customers of a caliber such as yours. We are therefore offering you, Ms. Bloomwood, as a graduate, a free extended overdraft facility of £2,000 during the first 2 years of your career. Should you decide to open an account with Endwich, this facility will be available immediately, subject to status. I do hope you decide to take advantage of this unique offer and look forward to receiving your completed form. Once again, congratulations. Yours sincerely, Nigel Fairs, Graduate Marketing Manager. Endwich, because we care. Endwich Bank, Fulham Branch, 3 Fulham Road, London, SW6 9JH. Ms. Rebecca Bloomwood, Flat 2, 4 Burnie Road, London, SW6 8FD. 10th September, 1999. Dear Ms. Bloomwood, further to my letters of 3rd of May, 29th of July, and 14th of August, you will be aware that your free graduate overdraft facility is due to end on the 19th of September, 1999. You will also be aware that you have substantially exceeded the agreed limit of £2,000. The current balance stands at a debit of £3,794.56. Perhaps you would be kind enough to telephone my assistant, Erica Parnell, at the above number to arrange a meeting concerning this matter. Yours sincerely, Derek Smeath, Manager. Endwich, because we care. Endwich Bank, Fulham Branch, 3 Fulham Road, London, SW6 9JH. Ms. Rebecca Bloomwood, Flat 2, 4 Burnie Road, London, SW6 8FD. 22nd of September, 1999. Dear Ms. Bloomwood, I am sorry to hear that you have broken your leg. When you have recovered, perhaps you would be kind enough to ring my assistant, Erica Parnell, and arrange a meeting to discuss your ongoing overdraft needs. Yours sincerely, Derek Smeath, Manager. Endwich, because we care. Chapter 1. Okay. Don't panic. Don't panic. It's only a visa bill. It's a piece of paper. A few numbers. I mean, just how scary can a few numbers be? I stare out of the office window at a bus driving down Oxford Street, willing myself to open the white envelope sitting on my cluttered desk. It's only a piece of paper, I tell myself for the thousandth time. And I'm not stupid, am I? I know exactly how much this visa bill will be. Sort of. Roughly. It'll be about £200. £300 maybe. Yes, maybe £300. £350 max. I casually close my eyes and start to tot up. There was that suit in Jigsaw, and there was dinner with Suze at Quaglino's, and there was that gorgeous red and yellow rug. The rug was £200, come to think of it. But it was definitely worth every penny. Everyone's admired it. Or, at least, Suze has. And the Jigsaw suit was on sale, 30% off. So that was actually saving money. I open my eyes and reach for the bill. As my fingers hit the paper, I remember new contact lenses. £95. Quite a lot. But, I mean, I had to get those, didn't I? What am I supposed to do? Walk around in a blur? And I had to buy some new solutions, and a cute case, and some hypoallergenic eyeliner. So that takes it up to 400? At the desk next to mine, Claire Edwards looks up from her post. She's sorting all her letters into neat piles, just like she does every morning. She puts rubber bands around them and puts labels on them saying things like, "Answer immediately," and "Not urgent, but respond." I loathe Claire Edwards. "Okay, Becky," she says. "Fine," I say lightly. "Just reading a letter." I reach gaily into the envelope, but my fingers don't quite pull out the bill. They remain clutched around it, while my mind is seized, as it is every month, by my secret dream. Do you want to know about my secret dream? It's based on a story I once read in the Daily World about a mix-up at a bank. I loved this story so much, I cut it out and stuck it onto my wardrobe door. Two credit card bills were sent to the wrong people. And, get this, each person paid the wrong bill without realising. They paid off each other's bills, without even checking them. And ever since I read that story, my secret fantasy has been that the same thing will happen to me. I mean, I know it sounds unlikely, but if it happened once, it can again, can't it? Some dotty old woman in Cornwall will be sent my humongous bill and will pay it without even looking at it. And I'll be sent her bill for 3 tins of cat food at 59p each, which naturally I'll pay without question. Fair's fair, after all. A smile is plastered over my face as I gaze out of the window. I'm convinced that this month it'll happen. My secret dream is about to come true. When I eventually pull the bill out of the envelope, goaded by Claire's curious gaze, my smile falters, then disappears. Something hot is blocking my throat. I think it could be panic. The page is black with type. A series of familiar names rushes past my eyes like a mini shopping mall. I try to take them in, but they're moving too fast. Thornton's, I managed to glimpse. Thornton's chocolates? What was I doing in Thornton's chocolates? I'm supposed to be on a diet. This bill can't be right. This can't be me. I can't possibly have spent all this money. Don't panic! I yell internally. The key is not to panic. Just read each entry slowly, one by one. I take a deep breath and force myself to focus calmly, starting at the top. W.H. Smith. Well, that's okay. Everyone needs stationery. Boots. Everyone needs shampoo. Specsavers. Essential. Oddbins. Bottle of wine. Essential. Our price. Our price? Oh, yes. The New Charlatans album. Well, I had to have that, didn't I? Bella Pasta, supper with Caitlin. Oddbins, bottle of wine, essential. Esso, petrol doesn't count. Quaglino's, expensive, but it was a one-off. Pret-a-manger, that time I ran out of cash. Oddbins, bottle of wine, essential. Rugs to riches, what? Oh yes, stupid rug. La Senza, sexy underwear for date with James. Argent provocateur, even sexier underwear for date with James, like I needed it. Body shop, that skin brusher thing which I must use. Next, fairly boring white shirt, but it was in the sale. Millets. I stop in my tracks. Millets? I never go into millets. What would I be doing in millets? I stare at the statement in puzzlement, wrinkling my brow and trying to think. And then suddenly, the truth dawns on me. It's obvious. Someone else has been using my card. Oh my God! I, Rebecca Bloomwood, have been the victim of a crime. Now it all makes sense. Some criminals pinched my credit card and forged my signature. Who knows where else they've used it? No wonder my statement's so black with figures. Someone's gone on a spending spree round London with my card, and they thought they would just get away with it. But how? I scrabble in my bag for my purse, open it, and there's my Visa card, staring up at me. I take it out and run my fingers over the glossy surface. Someone must have pinched it from my purse, used it, and then put it back. It must be someone I know. Oh my God! Who? I look suspiciously round the office. Whoever it is isn't very bright. Using my card at Millets. It's almost laughable, as if I'd ever shop there. I've never even been to Millets, I say aloud. Yes, you have, says Claire. What? I turn to her. No, I haven't. You bought Michael's leaving present for Millets, didn't you? I feel my smile disappear. Oh, bugger. Of course. The blue anorak for Michael. The blue sodding anorak from Millets. When Michael, our deputy editor, left 3 weeks ago, I volunteered to buy his present. I took the brown envelope full of coins and notes into the shop and picked out an anorak. Take it from me, he's that kind of guy. And at the last minute, now I remember, I decided to pay on credit and keep all that handy cash for myself. I can vividly remember fishing out the 4 or 5 pound notes and carefully putting them in my wallet, sorting out the pound coins and putting them in my coin compartment, and pouring the rest of the change into the bottom of my bag. Oh, good, I remember thinking. I won't have to go to the cash machine. I'd thought that 60 quid would last me for weeks. So what happened to it? I can't have just spent 60 quid without realising it. Can I? Why are you asking anyway? Says Claire, and she leans forward. I can see her beady little X-ray eyes gleaming behind her specs. She knows I'm looking at my visa bill. No reason, I say, briskly turning to the second page of my statement. But I've been put off my stride. Instead of doing what I normally do, look at the minimum payment required and ignore the total completely, I find myself staring straight at the bottom figure. £949.63. In clear black and white. For 30 seconds, I am completely motionless. Then, without changing expression, I stuff the bill back into the envelope. I honestly feel as though this piece of paper has nothing to do with me. Perhaps, if I carelessly let it drop down on the floor behind my computer, it will disappear. The cleaners will sweep it up, and I can claim I never got it. They can't charge me for a bill I never received, can they? I'm already composing a letter in my head. Dear Managing Director of Visa, your letter has confused me. What bill are you talking about, precisely? I never received any bill from your company. I did not care for your tone, and should warn you, I am writing to Anne Robinson of Watchdog. Or I could always move abroad. Becky? My head jerks up, and I see Claire holding this month's news list. Have you finished the piece on Lloyd's? Nearly, I lie. As she's watching me, I feel forced to summon it up on my computer screen, just to show I'm willing. This high-yield, 60-day access account offers tiered rates of interest on investments of over £2,000, I type onto the screen, copying directly from a press release in front of me. Long-term savers may also be interested in a new stepped-rate bond, which requires a minimum of £5,000. I type a full stop, take a sip of coffee, and turn to the second page of the press release. This is what I do, by the way. I'm a journalist on a financial magazine. I'm paid to tell other people how to organise their money. Of course, being a financial journalist is not the career I always wanted. No one who writes about personal finance ever meant to do it. People tell you they fell into personal finance. They're lying. What they mean is they couldn't get a job writing about anything more interesting. They mean they applied for jobs at The Times and The Express and Marie Claire and Vogue and GQ, and all they got back was piss off. So they started applying to Metalwork Monthly and Cheesemaker's Gazette and What Investment Plan? And they were taken on as the crappiest editorial assistant possible, on no money whatsoever, and were grateful. And they've stayed on, writing about metal or cheese or savings ever since. Because that's all they know. I myself started on the catchily titled Personal Investment Periodical. I learned how to copy out a press release and nod at press conferences and ask questions that sounded as though I knew what I was talking about. After a year and a half, believe it or not, I was headhunted to successful saving. Of course, I still know nothing about finance. People at the bus stop know more about finance than me. School children know more than me. I've been doing this job for 3 years now, and I'm still expecting someone to catch me out. That afternoon, Philip, the editor, calls my name, and I jump in fright. Rebecca, he says, a word. And he beckons me over to his desk. His voice seems lower all of a sudden, almost conspiratorial. And he's smiling at me, as though he's about to give me a piece of good news. Promotion, I think. It must be. He read the piece I wrote on international equity securities last week, in which I likened the hunt for long-term growth to the hunt for the perfect pair of summer mules, and was bowled over by how exciting I made it all sound. He knows it's unfair I earn less than Claire, so he's going to promote me to her level. Or even above. And he's telling me discreetly so Claire won't be jealous. A wide smile plasters itself over my face, and I get up and walk the 3 yards or so to his desk, trying to stay calm, but already planning what I'll buy with my raise. I'll get that swirly coat in whistles, and some black high-heeled boots from pied-à-terre. Maybe I'll go on holiday. And I'll pay off that blasted visa bill once and for all. I feel buoyant with relief. I knew everything would be okay. Rebecca, he's thrusting a card at me. I can't make this press conference, he says. But it could be quite interesting. Will you go? It's at Brandon Communications. I can feel the elated expression falling off my face like jelly. He's not promoting me. I'm not getting a raise. I feel betrayed. Why did he smile at me like that? He must have known he was lifting my hopes. Something wrong? Inquires Philip. No, I mutter. But I can't bring myself to smile. In front of me, my new swirly coat and high-heeled boots are disappearing into a puddle like the Wicked Witch of the West. No promotion. Just a press conference about... I turn over the card. About a new unit trust. How could anyone possibly describe that as interesting? Chapter 2. There's just one essential purchase I have to make on the way to the press conference, and that's the Financial Times. The FT is by far the best accessory a girl can have. Its major advantages are, 1, it's a nice colour, 2, it only cost 85 pence, 3, if you walk into a room with it tucked under your arm, people take you seriously. With an FT under your arm, you can talk about the most frivolous things in the world, and instead of thinking you're an airhead, people think you're a heavyweight intellectual who has broader interests too. At my interview for Successful Saving, I went in holding copies of the Financial Times and the Investor's Chronicle, and I didn't get asked about finance once. As I remember it, we spent the whole time talking about holiday villas and gossiping about other editors. So I stop at a newsstand and buy a copy of the FT. There's some huge headline about Rutland Bank on the front page, and I'm thinking maybe I should at least skim it, when I catch my reflection in the window of Denny and George. I don't look bad, I think. I'm wearing my black skirt from French Connection and a plain white T-shirt from Knickerbox, and a little Angora cardigan, which I got from M&S, but looks like it might be Agnes B. And my new square-toed shoes from Hobbs. Even better, although no one can see them, I know that underneath I'm wearing my gorgeous new matching knickers and bra with embroidered yellow rosebuds. They're the best bit of my entire outfit. In fact, I almost wish I could be run over so that the world would see them. It's a habit of mine, itemising all the clothes I'm wearing, as though for a fashion page. I've been doing it for years, ever since I used to read Just 17. Every issue, they'd stop a girl on the street, take a picture of her, and list all her clothes. T-shirt, Chelsea Girl. Jeans, Topshop. Shoes, borrowed from friend. I used to read those lists avidly. And to this day, if I buy something from a shop that's a bit uncool, I cut the label out, so that if I'm ever stopped in the street, I can pretend I don't know where it's from. So anyway, there I am, with the FT tucked under my arm, thinking I look pretty good, and half wishing someone from Just 17 would pop up with the camera, when suddenly my eye focuses and snaps to attention, and my heart stops. In the window of Denny and George is a discreet sign. It's dark green with cream lettering, and it says, "Sale." I stare at it, and my skin's all prickly. It can't be true. Denny and George can't be having a sale. They never have a sale. Their scarves and pashminas are so coveted, they could probably sell them at twice the price. Everyone I know in the entire world aspires to owning a Denny and George scarf. Except my mum and dad, obviously. My mum thinks if you can't buy it at Bentall's of Kingston, you don't need it. I swallow, take a couple of steps forward, then push open the door of the tiny shop. The door pings, and the nice blonde girl who works there looks up. I don't know her name, but I've always liked her. Unlike some snotty cows in clothes shops, she doesn't mind if you stand for ages staring at clothes you really can't afford to buy. Usually what happens is, I spend half an hour lusting after scarves in Denny and George, then go off to accessorise and buy something to cheer myself up. I've got a whole drawerful of Denny and George substitutes. "Hi," I say, trying to stay calm. You're having a sale?" "Yes," the blonde girl smiles. "Bit unusual for us." My eyes sweep the room. I can see rows of scarves, neatly folded, with dark green, 50% off signs above them. Printed velvet, beaded silk, embroidered cashmere, all with the distinctive Denny and George signature. They're everywhere. I don't know where to start. I think I'm having a panic attack. "You always like this one, I think," says the nice blonde girl, taking out a shimmering grey-blue scarf from the pile in front of her. "Oh, God, yes. I remember this one. It's made of silky velvet overprinted in a paler blue and dotted with iridescent beads. As I stare at it, I can feel little invisible strings silently tugging me toward it. I have to touch it. I have to wear it. It's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen." The girl looks at the label. "Reduced from £340 to £120. She comes and drapes the scarf around my neck, and I gape at my reflection. There is no question. I have to have this scarf. I have to have it. It makes my eyes look bigger. It makes my haircut look more expensive. It makes me look like a different person. I'll be able to wear it with everything. People will refer to me as the girl in the Denny and George scarf." "I'd snap it up if I were you," the girl smiles at me. "There's only one of these left." Involuntarily, I clutch at it. "I'll have it," I gasp. "I'll have it." As she's laying it out on tissue paper, I take out my purse, open it up, and reach for my Visa card in one seamless, automatic action. But my fingers hit bare leather. I stop in surprise and start to rummage through all the pockets of my purse, wondering if I stuffed my card back in somewhere with a receipt, or if it's hidden underneath a business card. And then, with a sickening thud, I remember. It's on my desk. How could I have been so stupid? How could I have left my Visa card on my desk? What was I thinking? The nice blonde girl is putting the wrapped scarf into a dark green Denny and George box. My mouth is dry with panic. What am I going to do? "How would you like to pay?" she says pleasantly. My face flames red, and I swallow hard. "I've just realised I've left my credit card at the office," I stutter. "Oh," says the girl, and her hands pause. "Can you hold it for me?" The girl looks dubious. "For how long?" "Until tomorrow?" I say desperately. "Oh, God, she's pulling a face. Doesn't she understand?" "I'm afraid not," she says. "We're not supposed to reserve sale stock." "Just until later this afternoon, then," I say quickly. "What time do you close?" 6. 6. I feel a combination of relief and adrenaline sweeping through me. Challenge Rebecca. I'll go to the press conference, leave as soon as I can, then take a taxi back to the office. I'll grab my Visa card, tell Philip I left my notebook behind, come here, and buy the scarf. "Can you hold it until then?" I say beseechingly. "Please? Please?" The girl relents. "Okay, I'll put it behind the counter." "Thanks," I gasp. I hurry out of the shop and down the road toward Brandon Communications. "Please let the press conference be short," I pray. "Please don't let the questions go on too long. Please, God, please let me have that scarf." As I arrive at Brandon Communications, I can feel myself begin to relax. I do have 3 whole hours after all, and my scarf is safely behind the counter. No one's going to steal it from me. There's a sign up in the foyer saying that the Foreland Exotic Opportunities press conference is happening in the Artemis suite, and a man in uniform is directing everybody down the corridor. This means it must be quite big. Not television cameras, CNN, World's Press on tenterhooks big, obviously. But fairly good turnout big. A relatively important event in our dull little world. As I enter the room, there's already a buzz of people milling around, and waitresses circulating with canapés. The journalists are knocking back the champagne as if they've never seen it before. The PR girls are looking supercilious and sipping water. A waiter offers me a glass of champagne, and I take 2. One for now, one to put under my chair for the boring bits. In the far corner of the room, I can see Ellie Granger from Investors Weekly News. She's been pinned into a corner by 2 earnest men in suits and is nodding at them with a glassy look in her eye. Ellie's great. She's only been on Investors Weekly News for 6 months, and already she's applied for 43 other jobs. What she really wants to be is a beauty editor on a magazine, and I think she'd be really good at it. Every time I see her, she's got a new lipstick on, and she always wears really interesting clothes. Like today. She's wearing an orange chiffon-y shirt over a pair of white cotton trousers, espadrilles, and a big wooden necklace. The kind I could never wear in a million years. What I really want to be is Fiona Phillips on GMTV. I could really see myself sitting on that sofa, joshing with Eamon every morning and interviewing lots of soap stars. Sometimes, when we're very drunk, we make pacts that if we're not somewhere more exciting in 3 months, we'll both leave our jobs. But then, the thought of no money, even for a month, is almost more scary than the thought of writing about depository trust companies for the rest of my life. Rebecca, glad you could make it. I look up and almost choke on my champagne. It's Luke Brandon, head honcho of Brandon Communications, staring straight at me as if he knows exactly what I'm thinking. Staring straight down at me, I should say. He must be well over 6 feet tall, with dark hair and dark eyes, and... wow! Isn't that suit nice? An expensive suit like that almost makes you want to be a man. It's inky blue with a faint purple stripe, single-breasted, with proper horn buttons. As I run my eyes over it, I find myself wondering if it's by Oswald Boateng, and whether the jacket's got a silk lining in some stunning colour. If this were someone else, I might ask. But not Luke Brandon. No way. I've only met him a few times, and I've always felt slightly uneasy around him. For a start, he's got such a scary reputation. Everyone talks all the time about what a genius he is, even Philip, my boss. He started Brandon Communications from nothing, and now it's the biggest financial PR company in London. A few months ago, he was listed in the Mail as one of the cleverest entrepreneurs of his generation. It said his IQ was phenomenally high, and he had a photographic memory. But it's not just that. It's that he always seems to have a frown on his face when he's talking to me. It'll probably turn out that the famous Luke Brandon is not only a complete genius, but he can read minds too. He knows that when I'm staring up at some boring graph, nodding intelligently, I'm really thinking about a gorgeous black top I saw in Joseph and whether I can afford the trousers as well. You know Alicia, don't you? Luke is saying, and he gestures to the immaculate blonde girl beside him. I don't know Alicia, as it happens, but I don't need to. They're all the same, the girls at Brandon C, as they call it. They're well-dressed, well-spoken, are married to bankers, and have zero sense of humour. Alicia falls into the identikit pattern exactly, with her baby blue suit, silk Hermes scarf, and matching baby blue shoes, which I've seen in Russell and Bromley, and they cost an absolute fortune. I bet she's got the bag as well. She's also got a suntan, which must mean she's just come back from Mauritius or somewhere. And suddenly, I feel a bit pale and weedy in comparison. Rebecca, she says, coolly grasping my hand. You're on successful saving, aren't you? That's right, I say equally coolly. It's very good of you to come today, says Alicia. I know you journalists are terribly busy. No problem, I say. We like to attend as many press conferences as we can. Keep up with industry events. I feel pleased with my response. I'm almost fooling myself. Alicia nods seriously, as though everything I say is incredibly important to her. So, tell me, Rebecca, what do you think about today's news? She gestures to the FT under my arm. Quite a surprise, didn't you think? Oh, God. What's she talking about? It's certainly interesting, I say, still smiling, playing for time. I glance around the room for a clue, but there's nothing. What's she talking about? Have interest rates gone up or something? I have to say, I think it's bad news for the industry, says Alicia earnestly. But of course, you must have your own views. She's looking at me, waiting for an answer. I can feel my cheeks flaming bright red. How can I get out of this? After this, I promise myself, I'm going to read the papers every day. I'm never going to be caught out like this again. I agree with you, I say eventually. I think it's very bad news. My voice feels strangled. I take a quick swig of champagne and pray for an earthquake. Were you expecting it? Alicia says. I know you journalists are always ahead of the game. I certainly saw it coming, I say, and I'm pretty sure I sound convincing. And now this rumour about Scottish Prime and Flagstaff Life going the same way. She looks at me intently. Do you think that's really on the cards? It's difficult to say, I reply, and take a gulp of champagne. What rumour? Why can't she leave me alone? Then I make the mistake of glancing up at Luke Brandon. He's staring at me, his mouth twitching slightly. Oh, shit. He knows I don't have a clue, doesn't he? Alicia, he says abruptly, that's Maggie Stevens coming in. Could you...
Absolutely,
she says, trained like a racehorse, and starts to move smoothly toward the door. And Alicia, adds Luke, and she quickly turns back. I want to know exactly who fucked up on those figures.
Yes,
gulps Alicia, and walks off. God, he's scary. And now we're on our own. I think I might quickly run away.
Well, I say brightly, I must just go and...
But Luke Brandon is leaning toward me. SBG announced that they have taken over Rutland Bank this morning, he says quietly. And of course, now that he says it, I remember that front page headline.
I know they did, I reply haughtily. I read it in the FT.
And before he can say anything else, I walk off to talk to Ellie. As the press conference is about to start, Ellie and I sidle toward the back and grab two seats together. We're in one of the bigger conference rooms, and there must be about 100 chairs arranged in rows, facing a podium and a large screen. I open my notebook, write Brandon Communications at the top of the page, and start doodling swirly flowers down the side. Beside me, Ellie's dialing her telephone horoscope on her mobile phone. I take a sip of champagne, lean back, and prepare to relax. There's no point listening at press conferences. The information's always in the press pack, and you can work out what they were talking about later. In fact,
and wondering whether anyone would notice if I took out a pot of hard candy and did my nails, when suddenly the awful Alicia ducks her head down to mine.
"Rebecca?"
"Yes," I say lazily.
"Phone call for you. It's your editor."
"Philip," I say stupidly, as though I have a whole array of editors to choose from.
"Yes."
She looks at me as though I'm a moron and gestures to a phone on a table at the back. Ellie gives me a questioning look and I shrug back.
Philip's never phoned me at a press conference before.
I feel rather excited and important as I walk to the back of the room.
"Perhaps there's an emergency at the office. Perhaps he's scooped an incredible story and wants me to fly to New York to follow up a lead."
"Hello, Philip," I say into the receiver. Then immediately I wish I'd said something thrusting and impressive, like a simple, "Yep."
"Rebecca, listen, sorry to be a bore," says Philip, "but I've got a migraine coming on. I'm going to head off home."
"Oh," I say, puzzledly.
"And I wondered if you could run a small errand for me."
"An errand? If he wants somebody to buy him Tylenol, he should get a secretary."
"I'm not sure," I say discouragingly. "I'm a bit tied up here."
"When you've finished there, the Social Security Select Committee is releasing its report at 5 o'clock. Can you go and pick it up? You can go straight to Westminster from your press conference."
"What?" I stare at the phone in horror. "No, I can't pick up a bloody report. I need to pick up my Visa card. I need to secure my scarf."
"Can't Claire go?" I say. "I was going to come back to the office and finish my research on..."
"What am I supposed to be writing about this month?"
"On mortgages."
"Claire's got a briefing in the city, and Westminster's on your way home to trendy Fulham, isn't it?"
Philip always has to make a joke about me living in Fulham. Just because he lives in Harpenden and thinks anyone who doesn't live in lovely leafy suburbia is mad.
"You can just hop off the train," he says. "Pick it up and hop back on again."
Oh, God. I close my eyes and think quickly. An hour here, rush back to the office, pick up my Visa card, back to Denny and George, get my scarf, rush to Westminster, pick up the report. I should just about make it.
"Fine," I say. "Leave it to me."
I sit back down, just as the lights dim and the words "Far Eastern Opportunities" appear on the screen in front of us. There is a colourful series of pictures from Hong Kong, Thailand, and other exotic places, which would usually have me thinking wistfully about going on holiday. But today, I can't relax, or even feel sorry for the new girl from Portfolio Week, who's frantically trying to write everything down and will probably ask 5 questions because she thinks she should. I'm too concerned about my scarf. What if I don't make it back in time? What if someone puts in a higher offer? The very thought makes me panic. Then, just as the pictures of Thailand disappear and the boring graphs begin, I have a flash of inspiration. Of course! I'll pay cash for the scarf. No one can argue with cash. I can get £100 out on my cash card. So all I need is another £20, and the scarf is mine. I tear a piece of paper out of my notebook, write on it, "Can you lend me 20 quid?" and pass it to Ellie, who's still surreptitiously listening to her mobile phone. I wonder what she's listening to. Can't still be her horoscope, surely. She looks down, shakes her head, and writes, "No can do. Bloody machine swallowed my card. Living off luncheon vouchers at moment." Damn. I hesitate, then write, "What about credit card? I'll pay you back, honest. And what are you listening to?" I pass the page to her, and suddenly the lights go up. The presentation has ended, and I didn't hear a word of it. People shift around on their seats, and a PR girl starts handing out glossy brochures. Ellie finishes her call and grins at me. "Love life prediction," she says, tapping in another number. "It's really accurate stuff." "Load of old bullshit, more like." I shake my head disapprovingly. "I can't believe you go for all that rubbish.
call yourself a financial journalist. No, says Ellie. Do you? And we both start to giggle, until some old bag from one of the nationals turns round and gives us an angry glare.
Ladies and gentlemen,
a piercing voice interrupts us, and I look up. It's Alicia, standing up at the front of the room. She's got very good legs, I note resentfully.
As you can see, the Foreland Exotic Opportunities Savings Plan represents an entirely new approach to investment.
She looks around the room, meets my eye, and smiles coldly. Exotic opportunities, I whisper scornfully to Ellie and point to the leaflet. Exotic prices, more like. Have you seen how much they're charging? I always turn to the charges first, just like I always look at the price tag first.
Ellie rolls her eyes sympathetically, still listening to the phone. Foreland investments are all about adding value, Alicia is saying in her snooty voice. Foreland investments offer you more.
They charge more. You lose more, I say aloud, without thinking. And there's a laugh around the room. God, how embarrassing. And now, Luke Brandon's lifting his head too. Quickly, I look down and pretend to be writing notes. Although, to be honest, I don't know why I even pretend to write notes. It's not as if we ever put anything in the magazine except the puff that comes on the press release. Foreland Investments takes out a whopping double-page spread advertisement every month. And they took Philip on some fantastic research, ha-ha, trip to Thailand last year. So we're never allowed to say anything except how wonderful they are. Like that's really any help to our readers. As Alicia carries on speaking, I lean toward Ellie.
So listen, I whisper. Can I borrow your credit card?
All used up, hisses Ellie apologetically. I'm up to my limit. Why do you think I'm living off LVs?
But I need money, I whisper. I'm desperate. I need 20 quid.
I've spoken more loudly than I intended, and Alicia stops speaking.
Perhaps you should have invested with Foreland Investments, Rebecca, says Alicia,
and another titter goes round the room. A few faces turn round to gawk at me, and I stare back at them lividly.
They're fellow journalists, for God's sake. They should be on my side. National Union of Journalists Solidarity and all that.
Not that I've ever actually got round to joining the NUJ, but still.
What do you need 20 quid for? Says Luke Brandon from the front of the room.
My aunt, I say defiantly. She's in hospital, and I wanted to get her a present.
The room is silent. Then, to my disbelief, Luke Brandon reaches into his pocket, takes out a £20 note, and gives it to a guy in the front row of journalists. He hesitates, then passes it back to the row behind. And so it goes on, a 20-quid note being passed from hand to hand, making its way to me like a fan at a gig being passed over the crowd. As I take hold of it, a round of applause goes round the room, and I blush.
Thanks, I say awkwardly. I'll pay you back, of course.
My best wishes to your aunt, says Luke Brandon.
Thanks, I say again.
Then I glance at Alicia and feel a little dart of triumph. She looks utterly deflated. Toward the end of the question and answer session, people begin slipping out to get back to their offices. This is usually when I slip out to go and buy a cappuccino and browse in a few shops. But today, I don't. Today, I decide I will stick it out until the last dismal question about tax structures. Then, I'll go up to the front and thank Luke Brandon in person for his kind, if embarrassing, gesture. And then I'll go and get my scarf. Yippee! But, to my surprise, after only a few questions, Luke Brandon gets up, whispers something to Alicia, and heads for the door.
Thanks,
I mutter as he passes my chair. But I'm not sure he even hears me.
The tube stops in a tunnel for no apparent reason. 5 minutes go by. Then 10. I can't believe my bad luck. Normally, of course, I long for the tube to break down, so I've got an excuse to stay out of the office for longer. But today, I behave like a stressed businessman with an ulcer. I tap my fingers and sigh and peer out of the window into the blackness. Part of my brain knows I've got plenty of time to get to Denny and George before it closes. Another part knows that even if I don't make it, it's unlikely the blonde girl will sell my scarf to someone else. But the possibility is there. So until I've got that scarf in my hands, I won't be able to relax. As the train finally gets going again, I sink into my seat with a dramatic sigh and look at the pale, silent man on my left. He's wearing jeans and sneakers, and I notice his shirt is on inside out. Gosh, I think in admiration. Did he read the article on deconstructing fashion in last month's Vogue, too? I'm about to ask him. Then I take another look at his jeans. Really nasty fake 501s. And his sneakers. Very new, very white. And something tells me he didn't. Thank God, I say instead. I was getting desperate there. It's frustrating, he agrees quietly. They just don't think, do they? I say. I mean, some of us have got crucial things we need to be doing. I'm in a terrible hurry. I'm in a bit of a hurry myself, says the man. If that train hadn't started moving, I don't know what I would have done. I shake my head. You feel so impotent. I know exactly what you mean, says the man intensely. They just don't realise that some of us, he gestures toward me, we aren't just idly travelling. It matters whether we arrive or not. Absolutely, I say. Where are you off to? My wife's in labour, he says. Our fourth. Oh, I say, taken aback. Well, gosh. Congratulations. I hope you... She took an hour and a half last time, says the man, rubbing his damp forehead. And I've been on this tube for 40 minutes already. Still, at least we're moving now. He gives a little shrug, then smiles at me. How about you? What's your urgent business? Oh, God. I'm going to... I stop feebly and clear my throat, feeling rather sheepish. I can't tell this man that my urgent business consists of picking up a scarf from Denny and George. I mean, a scarf. It's not even a suit or a coat or something worthy like that. It's not that important, I mumble. I don't believe that, he says nicely. Oh, now I feel awful. I glance up, and thank goodness it's my stop. Good luck, I say, hastily getting up. I really hope you get there in time. As I walk along the pavement, I'm feeling a bit shamefaced. I should have got out my 120 quid and given it to that man for his baby, instead of buying a pointless scarf. I mean, when you think about it, what's more important? Clothes or the miracle of new life? As I ponder this issue, I feel quite deep and philosophical. In fact, I'm so engrossed I almost walk past my turning. But I look up just in time and turn the corner and feel a jolt. There's a girl coming toward me, and she's carrying a Denny and George carrier bag. And suddenly everything is swept from my mind. Oh my God! What if she's got my scarf? What if she asked for it specially and that assistant sold it to her, thinking I wasn't going to come back? My heart starts to beat in panic, and I begin to stride along the street toward the shop. As I arrive at the door and push it open, I can barely breathe for fear. What if it's gone? What will I do? But the blonde girl smiles as I enter.
way, she says. It's waiting for you. Oh, thanks, I say in relief, and subside weakly against the counter. I honestly feel as though I've run an obstacle course to get here. In fact, I think they should list shopping as a cardiovascular activity. My heart never beats as fast as it does when I see a reduced by 50% sign. I count out the money in tens and twenties and wait, almost shivering as she ducks behind the counter and produces the green box. She slides it into a thick, glossy bag with dark green cord handles and hands it to me. And I almost want to cry out loud. The moment is so wonderful. That moment, that instant when your fingers curl round the handles of a shiny, uncreased bag, and all the gorgeous new things inside it become yours. What's it like? It's like going hungry for days, then cramming your mouth full of warm buttered toast. It's like waking up and realizing it's the weekend. It's like the better moments of sex. Everything else is blocked out of your mind. It's pure, selfish pleasure. I walk slowly out of the shop, still in a haze of delight. I've got a Denny and George scarf. I've got a Denny and George scarf. I've got... Rebecca? A man's voice interrupts my thoughts. I look up, and my stomach gives a lurch of horror. It's Luke Brandon. Luke Brandon is standing on the street right in front of me, and he's staring down at my carrier bag. I feel myself growing flustered. What's he doing here on the pavement anyway? Don't people like that have chauffeurs? Shouldn't he be whisking off to some vital financial reception or something? Did you get it all right? He says, frowning slightly. What? Your aunt's present. Oh, yes, I say, and swallow. Yes, I got it. Is that it? He gestures to the bag, and I feel a guilty blush spread over my cheeks. Yes, I say eventually. I thought a scarf would be nice. Very generous of you. Denny and George. He raises his eyebrows. Your aunt must be a stylish lady. She is, I say, and clear my throat. She's terribly creative and original. I'm sure she is, says Luke, and pauses. What's her name? Oh, God. I should have run as soon as I saw him, while I had a chance. Now I'm paralyzed. I can't think of a single female name. Ermintrude, I hear myself saying. Aunt Ermintrude, says Luke thoughtfully. Well, give her my best wishes. He nods at me and walks off, and I stand, clutching my bag, trying to work out if he guessed or not. Endwich Bank, Fulham Branch, 3 Fulham Road, London, SW6 9JH. Ms. Rebecca Bloomwood, Flat 2, 4 Burnie Road, London, SW6 8FD. 17th of November, 1999. Dear Ms. Bloomwood, I am sorry to hear that you have glandular fever. When you have recovered, perhaps you would be kind enough to ring my assistant, Erica Parnell, and arrange a meeting to discuss your situation. Yours sincerely, Derek Smeath, Manager. Endwich, because we care. Chapter 3. I walk through the door of our flat to see Suze, my flatmate, sitting in one of her strange yoga positions, with her eyes closed. Her fair hair is scrunched up in a knot, and she's wearing black leggings together with the ancient T-shirt she always wears for yoga. It's one her dad was wearing when he rode Oxford to victory,
and she says it gives her good vibes. For a moment, I'm silent. I don't want to disturb her, in case yoga is like sleepwalking, and you're not meant to wake people when they're doing it. But then, Suze opens her eyes and looks up, and the first thing she says is,
"Denny and George? Becky, you're not serious."
"Yes," I say, grinning from ear to ear. "I bought myself a scarf."
"Show me," says Suze, unwinding herself from the floor. "Show me, show me, show me."
She comes over and starts tugging at the strings of the carrier like a kid.
"I want to see your new scarf, show me."
This is why I love sharing a flat with Suze. Julia, my old flatmate, would have wrinkled her brow and said, "Denny and who?" Or, "That's a lot of money for a scarf." But Suze completely and utterly understands. If anything, she's worse than me. But then, she can afford to be. Although she's 25, like me, her parents still give her pocket money. It's called an allowance, and apparently comes from some family trust. But as far as I can see, it's pocket money. Her parents also bought her a flat in Fulham as a 21st birthday present, and she's been living in it ever since, half working and half dossing about. She was in PR for a very short while. And that's when I met her, on a press trip to an offshore bank on Guernsey. As a matter of fact, she was working for Brandon Communications. Without being rude, she admits it herself, she was the worst PR girl I've ever come across. She completely forgot which bank she was supposed to be promoting and started talking enthusiastically about one of their competitors. The man from the bank looked crosser and crosser, while all the journalists pissed themselves laughing. Suze got in big trouble over that. In fact, that's when she decided PR wasn't the career for her. The other way of putting it is that Luke Brandon gave her the sack as soon as they got back to London. Another reason not to like him. But the two of us had a whale of a time sloshing back wine until the early hours. Actually, Suze had a secret little weep at about 2 a.m. and said she was hopeless at every job she'd tried, and what was she going to do? I said I thought she was far too interesting and creative to be one of those snooty Brandon C girls. Which I wasn't just saying to be nice. It's completely true. I gave her a big hug, and she cried some more. Then we both cheered up and ordered another bottle of wine, and tried on all each other's clothes. I lent Suze my belt with the square silver buckle, which, come to think of it, she's never given back. And we kept in touch ever since. Then, when Julia suddenly upped and ran off with the professor supervising her PhD, she was a dark horse, that one, Suze suggested I move in with her. I'm sure the rent she charges is too low, but I've never insisted I pay the full market rate, because I couldn't afford it. As market rates go, I'm nearer Elephant and Castle than Fulham on my salary. How can normal people afford to live in such hideously expensive places? "Bex, open it up," Suze is begging. "Let me see." She's grabbing inside the bag with eager long fingers, and I pull it away quickly before she rips it. This bag is going on the back of my door, along with my other prestige carrier bags, to be used in a casual manner when I need to impress. Thank God they didn't print special sale bags. I hate shops that do that. What's the point of having a posh bag with sale splashed all over it? Very slowly, I take the dark green box out of the bag, remove the lid, and unfold the tissue paper. Then, almost reverentially, I lift up the scarf. It's beautiful. It's even more beautiful here than it was in the shop. I drape it around my neck and grin stupidly at Suze. "Oh, Bex," she murmurs. "It's gorgeous." For a moment, we are both silent. It's as though we're communing with a higher being, the god of shopping. Then Suze has to go and ruin it all. "You can wear it to see James this weekend," she says. "I can't," I say,
almost crossly, taking it off again. I'm not seeing him.
How come?
I'm not seeing him anymore. I try to give a nonchalant shrug.
Really?
Susie's eyes widen.
Why not? You didn't tell me.
I know. I look away from her eager gaze. It's a bit awkward.
Did you chuck him?
You hadn't even shagged him. Susie's voice is rising in excitement. She's desperate to know.
But am I desperate to tell?
For a moment, I consider being discreet. Then I think, oh, what the hell? I know, I say. That was the problem.
What do you mean?
Suze leans forward.
Bex, what are you talking about?
I take a deep breath and turn to face her. He didn't want to.
Didn't fancy you?
No, he... I close my eyes, barely able to believe this myself. He doesn't believe in sex before marriage.
You're joking.
I open my eyes to see Suze looking at me in horror, as if she's just heard the worst profanity known to mankind.
You are joking, Becky.
She's actually pleading with me.
I'm not.
I manage a weak smile.
It was a bit embarrassing, actually. I kind of pounced on him, and he had to fight me off.
The cringingly awful memory which I had successfully suppressed starts to resurface. I'd met James at a party a few weeks back, and this was the crucial third date. We'd been out for a really nice meal, which he'd insisted on paying for, and had gone back to his place, and had ended up kissing on the sofa.
Well, what was I supposed to think?
There he was, there I was. And make no mistake, if his mind was saying no, his body was certainly saying yes, yes, yes. So, being a modern girl, I reached for his trouser zip and began to pull it down. When he reached down and brushed me aside, I thought he was playing games and carried on even more enthusiastically. Thinking back, perhaps it took me longer than it should have to guess that he wasn't playing ball, so to speak. In fact, he actually had to punch me in the face to get me off him, although he was very apologetic about it afterward. Suze is gazing at me incredulously. Then she breaks into gurgles of laughter.
Had to fight you off? Bex, you man-eater!
Don't, I protest, half laughing, half embarrassed. He was really sweet about it. He asked, was I prepared to wait for him?
And you said, not bloody likely.
Sort of. I look away. In fact, carried away with the moment, I seem to remember issuing him a bit of a challenge.
Resist me now if you can, James, I recall saying in a husky voice,
gazing at him with what I thought were limpid sexual eyes.
But you'll be knocking at my door within the week.
Well, it's been over a week now, and I haven't heard a peep. Which, if you think about it, is pretty unflattering.
But that's hideous, Suze is saying. What about sexual compatibility?
Dunno, I shrug. I guess he's willing to take that gamble. Suze gives a sudden giggle.
Did you get a look at his...
No,
he wouldn't let me near it.
But could you feel it? Was it tiny? Suze's eyes gleam wickedly.
I bet it's teeny. He's hoping to kid some poor girl into marrying him and being stuck with a teeny todger all her life. Narrow escape, Bex.
She reaches for her packet of silk cut and lights up. Stay away, I say. I don't want my scarf smelling of smoke.
So, what are you doing this weekend? She asks, taking a drag.
Will you be okay? Do you want to come down to the country? This is how Suze always refers to her family's second home in Hampshire. The country. As though her parents own some small independent nation that nobody else knows about.
No, it's okay, I say, morosely picking up the TV guide.
I'm going to Surrey, visit my parents.
Oh well, says Suze.
Give your mum my love.
I will, I say. And you give my love to Pepper. Pepper is Suze's horse. She rides him about 3 times a year, if that. But whenever her parents suggest selling him, she gets all hysterical. Apparently, he costs £15,000 a year to run. £15,000! And what does he do for his money? Just stands in a stable and eats apples. I wouldn't mind being a horse.
Oh yeah, that reminds me, says Suze. The council tax bill came in. It's £300 each.
£300? I look at her in dismay.
What? Straight away?
Yeah. Actually, it's late. Just write me a cheque or something.
Fine, I say airily.
£300 coming up.
I reach for my bag and write a cheque out straight away. Suze is so generous about rent. I always pay my share of the bills, and sometimes add a bit extra. But still, I'm feeling cold as I hand it over. £300 gone, just like that. And I've still got that bloody visa bill to think of. Not a great month.
Oh, and someone called, adds Suze, and squints at a piece of paper.
Erica Parsnip? Is that right?
Erica Parsnip? Sometimes I think Suze's mind has been expanded just a little too often.
Parnell?
Erica Parnell from Endwich Bank. Can you call her? I stare at Suze, frozen in horror.
She called here?
She called this number?
Yes, this afternoon.
Oh, shit. My heart starts to thump.
What did you say? Did you say I've got glandular fever?
What? It's Suze's turn to stare. Of course I didn't say you've got bloody glandular fever.
Did she ask about my leg? Anything about my health at all?
No. She just said, where were you? And I said, you're at work.
Suze! I wail in dismay.
Well, what was I supposed to say?
You were supposed to say I was in bed with glandular fever and a broken leg.
Well, thanks for the warning.
Suze gazes at me, eyes narrowed, and crosses her legs back into the lotus position. Suze has got the longest, thinnest, wiriest legs I've ever known. When she's wearing black leggings, she looks like a spider.
What's the big deal anyway? She says, are you overdrawn?
Am I overdrawn? I smile back as reassuringly as I can. If Suze had any idea of my real situation, she'd need more than yoga to calm her down.
Just a tad.
I give a careless shrug. But I'm sure it'll work itself out. No need to worry.
There's silence, and I look up to see Suze tearing up my cheque. For a moment, I'm completely silenced. Then I stutter,
Suze, don't be stupid.
Pay me back when you're in the black, she says firmly.
Thanks, Suze, I say, in a suddenly thickened voice. And as I give her a big hug, I can feel tears jumping into my eyes.
Suze has got to be the best friend I've ever had. But there's a tense feeling in my stomach, which stays with me all evening, and is still there when I wake up the next morning. A feeling I can't even shift by thinking about my Denny and George scarf. I lie in bed, staring up at the ceiling, and for the first time in months, calculate how much I owe to everybody. The bank, Visa, my Harvey Nichols card, my Debenhams card, my Phoenix card, and now Sue's too.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.